Before we get started, I'd like to ask if you have a cell phone with you to please put it on vibrate, mute it, or turn it off for the duration of the service. Good afternoon. Actually, good morning. Sorry, I'm ahead of myself. A long time ago, the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes wrote that for everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. Those words are so true. There is a time to be born, to experience everything as new and fresh, and to marvel at the wonder and the beauty of God's creation. There's a time to grow, to expand our horizons, to dream our dreams, to reach out for our goals, to succeed, to fall short, to try again. There's a time to fall in love, to be married, to raise a family. There's a time to rest, to sit back and reflect on all that has gone before, and to watch those we have trained, those we have mentored, those we love take their own first steps of birth and growth and discovery. And finally, there is a time to die, a time when we no longer draw our breath on this earth, a time to struggle no more, a time to suffer no more. But death is not the end of our story. And that's why the Apostle Paul could write to the Thessalonians that we do not grieve as those without hope, because we do have hope. It's not a hope that rises and falls with the winds of change that blow through our world, nor is it a hope that can be thwarted by a sudden and catastrophic tragedy. It is a hope that is timeless. It's boundless. It's a hope that's grounded in the promises we have from God that there awaits for us a time called eternity and the gift of life everlasting. It's a hope grounded in the promises of God Almighty, who's promised to never leave us or forsake us, and who has promised that there is a place reserved for us at the heavenly banquet table. It is a hope that is grounded in the knowledge that God walks with us through every season of our lives. We are never left alone. And friends, those are mighty promises indeed. And that's why we not only gather to mourn a loss, but we gather to celebrate life, Kelly's life. Because we know that our time here on earth does not define the limits of our life. For we believe that in dying, Christ destroyed our death, and that in rising, Christ restored our life. We believe that Christ will come again in glory. And just as in baptism we put on Christ, we believe that in Christ we will be clothed with glory. Here and now, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. This is our hope, a hope grounded in the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, a hope grounded in the promises and faithfulness of God. Today we've gathered to mourn the passing and to celebrate the life of a truly wonderful woman named Kelly Versteeg. We mourn because we have lost someone dear to us. We've lost a daughter, a partner, a mother, a friend. We've lost someone who made us better simply because she was a part of our lives. She was someone who was gentle, loving voice in an otherwise chaotic and sometimes very unkind world. But we also gather to celebrate the promise of resurrected life, the season of eternity that God has promised us through his Son, Jesus Christ. In the spirit of that promise, may God the Father, who loved us so much that he sent his only Son into this world, grant us grace, that in our pain we may find comfort, in our sorrow we may find hope, and in death we may find resurrection. To that end, I invite you to hear now words of comfort and grace that come to us from the pages of Holy Scripture. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. For I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. So do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid. You know, one of the ways we draw upon the wellspring of our faith is through music. And today we're going to dip our spirits into that well a couple times, and I want to start by inviting you to turn in the hymnal to page 707. That's the hymnal. Number 707, and join me in singing the hymn of promise. And I invite you, as you are able, to please stand as we sing. Please be seated. Would you bow your hearts with mine in prayer? O Lord God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we praise you for Kelly, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home a home not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I have often said that I know of no better passage in all of Scripture that captures the essence of our hope and our faith than the words of the 23rd Psalm. It is that passage that reminds us that even in times that make no sense, we are not alone, that God is with us, holding us, walking with us, guiding us, and comforting us. And so I want you to invite you to join me in reciting these wonderful words of hope and comfort as you should find them printed in the bulletin that hopefully you picked up on the way in. Join me if you would. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Kelly touched so many lives. You look around, you can see that's true. But some lives she touched in very powerful ways, and there are a few folks who are going to come up and express what that means to them. And so I want to start by inviting Julia and Chris and the family to come up at this time. The voice is not Julia's, but the words are.
All right. We need to stay strong for Mom, because that's what Mom wants. Because we all love her.
I want to invite some of Kelly's childhood friends to come up and speak as well here.
We want to thank everyone for coming today. The amount of people that came to show their love for Kelly and her family, both last night and today, is a testament to who she was every day of her life. She had the biggest heart, the kindest soul, and purest love you could find on earth. She meant something to everyone in this room. She was a mother, a partner, a daughter, a sister, an aunt, a niece, a cousin, a godmother, and a friend. I met Kelly in our 7th grade homeroom class. We instantly hit it off and were joined at the hip ever since. We named ourselves Kelly Squared. I'm pretty sure that's probably all that we learned in algebra class. So most of you know Kelly as this sweet, soft-spoken, caring, and loving person, but some of us know Kelly's other side. Let's just say Kelly had a very mischievous side, especially when she was younger. For example, Kelly loved to prank people, like all the time. Anytime we would get together, she would always want to crank call people. These crank calls were always well thought out, and it was like she planned them for weeks. This was also back when we didn't have cell phones or caller ID, but as soon as they introduced *69 callback and then caller ID, she had to stop this hobby of hers. Kelly was not a fan of this new technology. Kelly also loved Halloween. Even when we were 16 years old, she refused to give up trick-or-treating because, as you all know, she had the biggest sweet tooth and she wanted that free candy. So one Halloween, Kelly begged Brenda and I to go trick-or-treating with her. We said, no way, we're too old. So we said we'd just follow you around the neighborhood in Brenda's 1980s Volkswagen Rabbit. So Kelly picked out this old costume from her attic when she was probably when she was like 11 or 12. The costume that she pulled out was a full body suit. She had decided to be a panda bear. This costume barely fit her, but she still insisted on wearing it. It had a mask, so she thought no one would know how old she really was. So Kelly went around the neighborhood trick-or-treating, and we followed along in the car. But don't ask me why she had this, but Brenda's car had a very loud intercom speaker outside of her car. So Brenda and I would yell over the loudspeaker as soon as she went up to the door. Come on, Brenda. As soon as she went up to the door, we'd say, don't feed the panda, she is too old. She was so mad at us. She definitely refused to share her candy with us. Kelly always enjoyed traveling, even when we were young. I remember this one year, Kelly invited me to go to Florida with her parents to visit her sister, Carrie. We woke up very early that morning to begin this long drive. I quickly fell asleep and continued to sleep for 18 of the 20 hours. Kelly again was not happy with me. But when we were not old enough to drive yet, I think we were about 14 or 15, Kelly and I would steal her parents' car and go for joyrides. Sorry, John and Linda. One time we went to go for a drive, but I put the wrong key in the ignition and got stuck. Again, Kelly was very mad at me. We spent hours trying to get it out and had no luck. We had to call our boyfriends at the time to come help us. Luckily, they were able to get it out, but it was just as soon as Linda and John were driving up the driveway. I'd like to point out these were all Kelly's ideas and not mine. It's pretty much true. She always made me drive, probably because back then she knew she would be a terrible driver. When Kelly turned 16 and was actually legal to drive, she would take her parents' car, but with permission this time. I'll never forget this car. It was a sky blue Dodge Aries. In case you don't know what that is, those cars are not meant to go very fast. For some reason, Kelly thought she was a drag racer in it. If anyone pulled up next to her at the stoplight, she would start to rev her engine, look over them, grip the steering wheel tight. One time this elderly man pulled up, she begins to challenge him. The light turns green and she floors it. She was beyond excited that she beat him that day. She had such a smile on her face, like she really thought it was an actual race and she won. We all know how much Kelly loved her sweets. She loved frosting, cupcakes, cookies. But when she was young, she especially loved raw cookie dough. When I would go to her house after school, we always had to make cookie dough. This was way before cookie dough was actually a thing. Her mom didn't want her eating this raw, so she would go and hide all of her leftovers. Her family would start finding it under her bed, under the couch, and at that point it was pretty moldy. Kelly went off to college and became an occupational therapist, which is no surprise. She always wanted to help people. For many years, she helped brain injury patients. My husband's brother was in a bad motorcycle accident when I first met him, and we were so lucky to have Kelly as his therapist. During this time, we were able to meet a lot of her amazing coworkers and friends who helped him out as well. She always had a great team of people around her. Something special that I want to share. The other day, Carrie, her sister, was telling me how special it made her feel because Kelly asked her to be in the delivery room with both Ava and Julia when they were born. I remember going in the hospital room and seeing Carrie tend to her sister's every need. Kelly shared with me just how special, Carrie shared just with me how special that made her feel. And it was such an amazing memory that she will never forget. Kelly was the most kind, sincere, genuine, and caring, thoughtful person. Her smile could light up a room. She was very close to her family, especially her mother and father. Kelly was one of the best mothers to her beautiful daughters, Ava and Julia. She loved Alex and Chris Jr. as if they were her own. She called them her bonus children. She would do anything for her children, her friends, her family, and even strangers. As much as she would get mad at Chris for being too loud, or whatever thing he was doing to annoy her at that time, which was pretty often, she truly loved him unconditionally. Kelly and I would have endless talks about all her friends, her coworkers, and how much she loved them, and she truly loved her job. Kelly was my sidekick for 32 years. She was my sister. She was like a sister to me. She was there for me no matter what. We had so many plans to grow old together, to travel, to raise our kids and our grandkids, and so much more. This is not fair for any of us. She left us all way too soon. Her memory will live forever through all of us. To Kelly's family, look around this room. All these people here today are your, as what Kelly would say, your bonus family. We are all here for you and anything you need. Never hesitate to reach out, no matter how big or small the ask is. We all are all here for you. Kelly, I want to thank you for bringing so much joy and happiness into our lives. We will miss you more than words can describe. Rest in peace, Kelly. And I promise to look after your family just like we always talked about. Until we meet again, I love you forever.
Good morning. Kelly and I were friends for over 30 years. Went to high school together, we were college roommates, and we've worked together for over 20 years. And as I reflected back and all the years, all the memories, the fun, the laughs, and I tried to put pen to paper on what I'd say to you this morning, words just couldn't convey just what Kelly meant to me. So I found a poem that spoke to me, and I'd like to share it with you. It's titled, Gone Too Soon. We weren't prepared for you to go. You were too full of life to be taken away from us so soon. It's still hard to believe. How much we'll miss your smile and your laughter in our ears. Your absence leaves a hole in us. We're filling with our tears. You taught us how to be our best, to in the moment live, to never hold a grudge for long, and loyal friendship give. Your presence was a light and joy we never realized would someday end. Just like the brilliant falling star that curved around heaven's bend. And though we cannot understand the reasons God took you now, we'll do our best to accept this loss, to carry on somehow. We can't bear to say goodbye, but you wouldn't want us mourning in distress. So we'll smile through these falling tears, counting our time with you quite blessed. We will remember you forever. For you, our hearts will always have room. We loved you more than you will ever know. You left us far too soon. We love you, Kelly.
Finally, I'd like to ask Kelly's boss, Sean, if he'd like to come up and...
Good morning, everybody. I do want to lead off with saying that I'm happy that I just went after Christy and her friends, because I have to now lead in with, in my role as Kelly's boss, she did an amazing job of covering up the mischievous side, because she never got in trouble in the year and a half that I got to work with her. So, well, I know some of you, thank you again to Kelly's family for just giving us the opportunity as sort of her work family to share some thoughts, and for giving us this time. So. I've had the pleasure over the last year and a half of being a coworker, a friend, a manager, and even a mentee of Kelly, even though I was her supervisor. I came to the IRU in the middle of a public health emergency, surrounded by the chaos of COVID-19, but luckily I was met with and introduced to the calm that was Kelly. Coming in as a very green director related to the intricacies of the IRU, Kelly helped me to learn the ins and outs, taught me that IRF pie is not a dessert dish. She schooled me in all things compliance and quality, to which Christy will be very happy to know I'm trying to continue with, and taught me that even after almost 18 years of being a PT, a supervisor, manager, and director, that I still had a lot I could learn about being my best self. Over nearly two decades of working as a PT, managing clinics with staff large and small, and being parts of many teams, you realize that there's a lot of good people that you have the opportunity to work with, but only a few great people to work with. Never a negative word to share, always exuding a calm and gentle nature, Kelly embodied those qualities most of us only strive to demonstrate, and she did so effortlessly just because it was her nature. At Hartford Healthcare, we constantly strive for excellence, maximizing the patient experience, delivering quality care, and supporting each other with what we like to call leadership behaviors. Our IRU has been so successful over the last 3 years because people like Kelly truly live these behaviors every day. Without greats like Kelly, we would not be where we are as a team. And sitting with Kelly just 2 weeks ago to complete her performance review, I wasn't so much challenged with what to write, but rather where to stop writing regarding her accomplishments, discretionary effort, demonstration of quality commitment, and most importantly, her kind spirit that has been so contagious to all those whose lives she's touched, and she certainly has touched all of us on the IRU. When I talk with my team, a lot of whom are here today, I ask for everyone's thoughts, and quickly my inbox filled up. The sentiments I receive demonstrate that irrelevant of role, years they work with Kelly, or level of relationship, Kelly deeply impacted all those she worked with, and I'd like to share just a few of those thoughts. Firstly, the candy that she shared with all of us could never come as close to being as sweet as Kelly. And I am putting in parentheses here, I wasn't really sure if she ate any of the candy, but now that I hear about the sweet tooth, I think she was in it for herself. So. But she did share with everybody, and not only that, she always asked what somebody's favorite candy was and made sure it was on site, and our Dr. Bhatti was very thankful for that. She never asked anyone for anything, but always asked what she could do for everyone. She had a way of making you feel like you were the most important person and was always in the moment. When you were in Kelly's presence, you just felt better. Quotes, one of a kind. You were a ray of sunshine. Down to earth with a heart of gold, radiated happiness, you made me realize what being in the moment really means. So I know I speak for our entire rehab team in stating that while Kelly leaves behind a very large void, she's left behind a group of people who are definitely made better by the time that she shared with us. We're challenged to move forward, but I think we will do so as a team, which is what she would want. Carrying forward her loving spirit, gentle approach, focus on quality, and the drive to provide our patients not just a good experience, but a great experience. Our IRU has been blessed to have what everybody's described as such a beautiful soul touch all of us, and we'll keep her spirit alive in all that we do. And again, thank you for providing myself and our team a moment to share these reflections and how important Kelly has been to each and every one of us.
been cold there in my shadow. To never know sunlight on your face. You were content to let me shine.
Many years ago, on the night he was betrayed and arrested, Jesus gathered in an upper room for one last meal with his disciples. After the supper, they walked across the valley to the Garden of Gethsemane, and Jesus paused to give them one last set of instructions. And among the things he said were these words, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." He didn't tell them that people would know they belonged to him if they gave large sums of money to the church or some other social cause. He didn't tell them that people would know they belonged to him if they showed up at church each week in their Sunday best. He didn't tell them that people would know they belonged to him if they served on every single committee in the church or in the community. He told them that people would know they belonged to him based upon the way they loved others. Because it's in the act of loving, you see, that the image of God, the face of Christ, shines through. Well, based on Jesus' own words, we know that Kelly Versteeg was indeed a follower of Jesus Christ. Because if there's one word that describes her, and that word is love. But just what is love? Well, the Apostle Paul summed it up pretty well when he said that love is patient and love is kind. It is not envious or boastful, or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Have you ever known anyone who exemplifies that description of love any better than Kelly? She was an amazing mom and stepmom. She was someone who was always there for others. She had a wonderful smile and a great sense of humor. Kelly loved many things, but the greatest love in her life was her family. Chris, Ava, Julia, Chris and Alexandra, her parents, her sisters. She called her parents every day to check in on them, to let them know that she was there for them and to let them know that she loved them. She kept in touch with friends. It's probably stating the obvious, but she has a lot of friends. And if you weren't a friend, just spend a few minutes with her and you became one very quickly. Paul's description of love is looking out for the best in others, encouraging others, helping them become all that God intended for them to be. That was Kelly. So what was her secret? How could she love like that? Love with such reckless abandon? How could she offer love that runs so contrary to a world that keeps records of wrongs, that celebrates looking out for number one instead of loving your neighbor as yourself? I think the answer is really very simple. Kelly belonged to Jesus Christ. And he taught her to love as he loved. And so she learned that when times got tough and when it was hard to love, and sometimes it's very hard to love, she could lean on him and he would get her through. Kelly learned a long time ago that Jesus was a source of strength that never ran out, that never failed, that always was more than enough for the job at hand. It was Jesus who gave Kelly the ability and a desire to focus on the good and the noble things of life. It was he who gave Kelly the ability to love completely without reservation or conditions. He gave Kelly strength and was her shield in any and all circumstances. And it was Jesus who was her constant companion, standing by her in the good times and the not so good times. And Kelly knew all of this. She had discovered at a very young age that all of Jesus' promises were true. She knew that God the Father loved her so much that he sent his son Jesus into this world, not to judge or condemn or punish the world, but so the world might be saved and the world might come to know what true love really is. She knew that following Jesus was not about rules and regulations and dour expressions. She knew it was not about church attendance or how hard she worked on what committee or program. She knew Jesus came so that we might have joy and peace and life and have these things in abundance. She knew that Jesus could be trusted, that she could take him at his word. And so she dove headfirst into that life of joy and peace and love that we all seek. She could confront anything that life threw at her with a thankful, loving heart, because she had an inexhaustible supply of strength and love. For she knew that the love of God was so great that nothing in this life or any other life, nothing that was or is, and certainly not death, could ever separate her from that love that we have in Jesus Christ. You know, you and I are living in some pretty tough times right now. Between the frightening uncertainty of this whole COVID-19 thing, to the daily ugliness and pettiness of our political landscape, it sometimes seems as if the only way to survive is to pull into a shell and keep everybody out at all costs. Kelly certainly didn't see it that way. She would see an opportunity to love. She would see an opportunity to laugh, and she would seize that opportunity. I had the opportunity to experience that firsthand a little more than 3.5 years ago. 3.5 years ago, my wife was nailed with a massive stroke of her own. She spent a long time down at Yale in the neuro ICU. And when the time came for her to go from there to a rehab hospital, as with many folks, I was, where do I even go? What are my options for this level? I didn't know. And while I was waiting and trying to figure it out, I got a phone call from someone in the church. I said, did you decide where Colleen's going yet? I said, no, I'm working on that. She said, well, it's all been fixed. Kelly said to tell you she's coming to Mount Sinai. I said, oh, really? She goes, it's all been arranged. She is coming to Mount Sinai. When we got there, my wife got care that not even the Queen of England or the First Lady of the United States could have rivaled. Because Kelly told them, you will take care of this lady. And what I've come to realize is that Kelly didn't do that because Colleen and I are anything special. She did that because she was special. She knew we needed help, and she could help, and so she did. It was as simple as that. You and I, and this world for that matter. Sorry, I can't see my notes. You and I in this world, we're poor today because we lost a woman who truly demonstrated the power of love that Jesus talked about. We have lost a woman who was a Christian in every sense of that word. We've lost someone who made our world a little brighter, no matter what was happening out there. She's gone home to glory. And believe me, nobody had to introduce her to Jesus when she arrived. He knew her well, and she knew him, and he was waiting for her with open arms to welcome her home. This wonderful woman who gave so much love to others walked into the very heart of love. And today she rests there from all of her labors here on earth. But the impact that she made on our lives continues to live on here and now. And so now it's our turn. Our turn to pick up the mantle that she left. Our turn to open our hearts to others. Our turn to love fully and completely, just as she loved. It's our turn to carry the legacy of life and love that Kelly Versteeg modeled for us out into the world for the glory of God. Amen. I'd like for us to close with one more hymn that reminds us of God's presence in every aspect of our lives. The hymn is called, I Was There to Hear Your Morning Cry. It's in the little black hymnal, The Faith We Sing. It's number 2051, 2051. And again, I invite you, as you're able, to stand and join in the singing. rejoice the day you were baptized to see your life unfold. I was there when you were but a child with a faith to suit you well. In a blaze of light you wandered off to find where demons dwell. When you heard the wonder of the word, I was there to cheer you on. You were raised to praise the living Lord, to whom you now belong. If you find someone to share your time, and you join your hearts as one, I'll be there to make your verses rhyme from dusk till rising sun. In the Middle Ages of your life, not too old, no longer young, I'll be there to guide you the night, complete what I've begun. When the evening gently closes in and you shut your weary eyes, I'll be there as I have always been, with just one more surprise. I was there to hear your morning cry. I'll be there when you are old. I rejoice the day you were baptized to see your life unfold.
Please be seated. Would you please bow your hearts with mine once again in prayer? Almighty God, our Father, from whom we come and to whom our spirits return, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. You are our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Grant us your blessing in this hour and enable us so to put our trust in you, that our spirits may grow calm and our hearts be comforted. Lift our eyes beyond the shadows of earth and help us to see the light of eternity. So may we find grace and strength for this and every time of need. O God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Kelly to us, now we give her back to you. Receive her into the arms of your mercy. Raise her up with all your people. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Kelly Versteeg. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints of light. Amen. And now with the boldness and the confidence of the children of God, may we lift our voices as one as we offer up the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On behalf of the family, I want to thank you all for being here today. Your presence means so very much to them. And on their behalf, I would like to invite you to a reception in Kelly's honor that will be held in our fellowship hall immediately after our return from the cemetery, which is
the wing on the other side of the green, on this other side of the playscape out there. And while you gather, as you share the food, as you visit with each other, share your stories and memories of Kelly. Because in the sharing of our stories, in the sharing of our memories, is when we truly do live on. I've also been asked to invite you to listen to a closing song after the benediction that captures quite a spirit of who Kelly was and the way she touched our lives. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, and may he grant you peace. Amen.
For all those times you stood by me, for all the truth that you made me see, for all the joy you brought to my life, for all the wrong that you made right, for every dream you made come true, for all the love I found in you, I'll be forever thankful, baby. You're the one who held me up, never let me fall. You're the one who saw me through it all. You were my strength when I was weak. You were my voice when I couldn't speak. You were my eyes when I couldn't see. You saw.
Oh, because you loved me.